following message is a presentation of Valley Metro Church, a community of believers dedicated to knowing God and making Him known.
Another thing we do besides worship, you know, every time we get together, we spend time right here. We spend time in the book. And the reason is that this Bible is God's love story to you and I. And something that's so profound about this Bible, it's not only His love story, it's beautiful, it's amazing, it's powerful. It says in its own self-description that He has given us, God has given us everything we need for life and godliness. And when you finally realize the authority of Scripture, the power and the authority of Scripture, it changes your life. And a lot of folks don't understand the authority of Scripture. So for them, this Bible is down here somewhere in their life. It's just some book written. And then there's some folks who realize, well, they say the Bible's the Word of God, so I should at least respect it, and they have one and maybe refer to it. So it's in their house maybe somewhere. Maybe you got a Bible app somewhere, which is great. But then there's a point where you realize personally the authority that is contained in this. And you begin to put it in a different place in your life. You begin to magnify the Word because you realize the power, the love, the authority contained inside this book right here. And everyone's got a different story on how that works out when you've discovered the power of God, when you've discovered the authority contained in the Bible. I remember when I was, years ago, I was new in the faith. I had a Bible and I started reading it because you're supposed to, right? So I'm reading one a little bit because you're supposed to. And a friend of mine, he said, hey, next year my family's going to be in New Zealand on a yacht. They sold their house. They're traveling around the world on a yacht. He said, if you want to come out for your week vacation and hang out with us in New Zealand, you're welcome to do it. And I thought, hey, that's like, when do you get an opportunity to do that, right? So I flew out to New Zealand. I met up with this family, dad and mom and their son, who was on college break. And in the morning, they said, first thing they did in the morning before they had breakfast, and they said, so Brian, we're a Christian family, so we do devotions every morning. And I'd never heard this before. I'd never seen a family act like this before. And they got up in the morning and they broke out the Word of God, and I saw them having this holy moment surrounding this book. And I'm thinking, man, I never even heard it. I've never seen that before. It's beautiful. They clearly understand some authority that I didn't quite appreciate just yet. And I remember sleeping on that boat. It was a 55-foot yacht and parked in a harbor off the coast of New Zealand. And nighttime, the moon, it was a full moon, shining in, you know, the little windows they got on the side of those yachts, those boats. I remember opening my Bible to read it because I'm supposed to. Again, I'm a newer believer. And I'm holding it out and I'm reading it with the light coming through. And as I'm reading it, all of a sudden, it came alive. It came alive. The words started to come off the pages. My hair started to stand up. And God started to say so clearly in His Spirit, it's alive. And I'm like, oh my goodness. I can't believe, now I understand why people begin to revolve their life around the authority contained in here, because some people observe the authority, other people don't quite understand. But when you do, when that happens to you, you begin to lift this up at a whole nother level. It's not something on the ground or something on the shelf anymore. It's something you elevate because it's God's word. It's living, it's active, it's sharper than a two-edged sword. It cuts between like bone and marrow. It can divide the intentions and the motives of the heart. Stuff we don't even know why we do what we do, this book reveals it. The purpose of life, this book reveals it. Your future, this book reveals it. How to love, how to forgive, how to give life, this book reveals it. And so you begin to understand authority on a whole new level. My prayer today is that you guys understand the authority. I know we're here because we love God and we're honoring Him today. But my prayer is that you understand the authority contained in this because it gives life and it's profound, absolutely profound. Speaking of authority, years ago there was a governor of Massachusetts who was running for his second term as governor, and he was trying really hard to get votes. So he got up in the morning. He was out all day going to every public event he could, every place he could go, and try to get people to vote for him. He's working so hard. He's working so hard, he didn't even eat breakfast or lunch. And finally, around dinner time, he goes to a church, a large church, having a barbecue. He figures, great, I'll get more votes here. And he's going around to all the people telling them, you know, hey, vote for me, vote for me. And so finally, there's a barbecue line. So he's famished, he's hungry. So he stands in line and he gets up to the front, and the lady puts one piece of chicken on his plate. And so he says, ma'am, do you mind if I get another one? And she said, nope, sorry, just one. And he said, ma'am, I'm really hungry. I really would appreciate another piece of chicken. And she says, nope, sorry, just one per customer. And then at this point, he's thinking, you know what? I think I need to throw my weight around a little bit. I need to tell this lady that I'm the governor, so she gives me more chicken. So he says to the lady, he says, ma'am, do you have any idea who I am? Do you know what my authority is? I have authority over this entire state. So can I have another piece of chicken now that you know who I am? And she says, do you know who I am? I'm the lady in charge of the chicken. Move on, mister. Authority. Authority. Today for authority, we're in Matthew chapter 8. And we're continuing where we left off in Scripture, and we're talking about authority today. And we're looking at specifically Jesus' authority to heal. And it matters a lot because it wasn't just his authority to heal. He's got something to say to us as his followers regarding his authority to heal, and how you and I partner with Jesus in the mission of Jesus, in the calling of Jesus. And so this matters a lot. And Matthew 8 verse 1 is where we're picking up, but I just want to catch the last two verses before that so we can set up where the story goes. Jesus was just sharing the Sermon on the Mount for the last two chapters in the Bible. He's sharing the most profound sermon ever preached. It was revolutionary. Israel never heard anything like it before, and he shared profound truths for the last two chapters. And this is how that section ended in Matthew 7:28. It says, when he had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching, because he taught as one who had authority and not as their teachers of the law. The crowds were absolutely amazed with Jesus. And they were not amazed at the way he spoke. They were not amazed at the way he delivered as an orator. They were not amazed at the way he positioned himself or any of these other things or the way he dressed. They weren't amazed with any, it wasn't his volume and the way he projected. It wasn't any of those things. They were amazed because they listened and they said, wow, that is authority. The crowds were amazed at his authority. The authority was evident. It wasn't his style, it was his authority. The Greek word for this is exousia, exousia. Now, there's a couple of words in the Bible that refer to power, and one of them is dunamis. You might have heard that word, the dynamite power of God. When there's a miracle happening, Book of Acts is full of dunamis, the power of God, boom, miracle. Things. The Greek word dunamis comes from our understanding of the word dynamite, literally something powerfully explosive. When the power of God came on his people and they began to walk out the Book of Acts, we begin to see dunamis, the dynamite power of God. That's one of the words used in the New Testament regarding believers for the dynamite power of God, the dunamis. This is a different word. It is also a word for power, but it's exousia. And it has to do with authority power, authority power. One way to look at this is if you were in jail, there would be two ways to get out. Somebody can blow you out of jail, the dunamis power, the dynamite power of God delivered you from jail, or a judge can say, I have the authority, let him free right now. Both ways you get out. One's explosive. and one has to do with authority. And the Bible speaks of both of these. And it uses these terms also in the life of believers. We see Jesus model this, but we also see this in the life of the first century church very, very clearly. So this word exousia is to have powerful jurisdiction over. You have jurisdiction over things, and so you have the authority to do things and change things in a realm that you have jurisdiction over. Parents, you have jurisdiction in your home. You have jurisdiction over your children. If you're a boss, you have jurisdiction over your staff, your employees, and all the way up. Governments have jurisdiction over its citizens and all the way up, but it's a matter of jurisdiction. So they're seeing Jesus, and they realize that he has the authority to teach. He has the authority to speak. Really, the New Testament, the New Covenant, the long-awaited Messiah is coming and bringing a full revelation of God's heart for his people. But it's not just the authority to teach. We're seeing now Jesus, for the first time in this gospel, step into a whole new realm, and it's the authority to heal. The authority to heal. Not just the authority to teach and speak life. He's the Word in flesh. He's been doing that for chapters now, but now he's about to step in to the authority to heal. And there's going to be a sequence, and we're going to learn a lot from his sequence. Now, when we talk about the word authority, it probably brings up a different feeling for you and I. Authority, some people like authority, some people don't like authority. We're all probably on different sides of the equation on that. Let me ask you an honest question. How many of you in this room feel like you would be in the category of a rule keeper? You keep the rules. How many? Show of hands. Okay. How many would say you're in the category of a rule breaker? Okay, half and half. Isn't that funny? Rule keepers, rule breakers. That just tells me that we have a different view of authority. Some view authority like that's the rules, I better keep those because authority, and God puts authorities in place and we're supposed to respect and honor those. But there's a little thing going on in our hearts going, who said so? Who said they're in charge? And why? There's something going on in the hearts of humans. So half the room is a rule keeper, half's a rule breaker, and I think a lot of it has to do with your view on authority. We all have a different experience with authority. I remember at 16 years old, I got a real crash course in authority. See, I was living in San Diego. My family had moved from New York City when I was 14, and we moved to San Diego. And at 16, I realized things were pretty dysfunctional in my home. Alcoholism was pretty rampant, and it was time for me to move out. And so at 16 years old, I already had a part-time job. I had bought a car. And so I had a car and a little bit of money, and I just figured it's not healthy to stay in this environment. It's time for me to go. So I was looking for a place to live, and I was looking for roommate situations or rooms to rent or whatever it might be. At 16 years old, I shared this with a friend of mine at school. I was a junior. My friend was a senior. I shared it with him, and he said, let me check with my parents. He gets back to me. He said, perfect. You can move in. You can rent a room from my family. And I'm like, seriously? He's like, yeah. I go, that's great. Awesome. So I remember on a Friday, I come home from school a little early, like 2 o'clock. I grab my guitar and my guitar amp and a couple of suitcases, and I move into his house. And his mom comes home about an hour or two later and says, so is Brian staying for dinner? And right there, I knew he had a problem. he said, no, Mom, Brian is here now. And she says, what do you mean he's here now? He's like, he's here now, he's moved in. And by the look on the mother's face, I'm thinking, oh, no. She's going, wait a second. We never talked about Brian moving. He's like, no, remember we had that. He's like, we said we're going to sit and talk to your father about this idea. And right there, my world turned on end. I realized my friend did not have the authority to invite me into the home. So the next 2 hours were the longest hours of my life, because you know at 16, when you moved out with your guitar and your amp and your two suitcases, you're not going to go back home when your parents are there with your stuff later that afternoon. That was not an option for this cowboy. So I waited 2 hours for the dad to come home, and the look on his face was astounding. It told me the whole story. So he went into the room with the mom and the son, and then he came out and called me and the son into the room. And he said, listen, here's the deal. You pay rent, you need to respect, you guys need to clean up, and if I have anything out of both of you, you're both out of here. Do you understand? Yes, sir. And so I thank God for that season in my life because I needed help, and that family was there for an important 6 months of my life. But I realized authority, and I realized who had it and who didn't have it. And so many of you have a different view of authority when we think of the term authority. And we're seeing in this passage Jesus rolling out authority, which is becoming evident to those around him. Not just the authority to teach, but the authority to heal. And we're going to roll through this section. If we can turn your Bible to Matthew 8, verse 1, and we're going to see the first healing in the Bible, in Matthew's gospel, the very first healing, and it's a man with leprosy, and it starts like this. When Jesus came down from the mountainside, large crowds followed him. A man with leprosy came and knelt before him and said, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. "I am willing," he said, "be clean." Immediately he was cleansed of his leprosy, and then Jesus said to him, "See that you don't tell anyone, but go show yourself to the priest and offer the gift Moses commanded as a testimony to them." So after the Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus has been teaching for the last two chapters profoundly, he comes down from the mountainside, and the very first encounter is a man with leprosy. When we think of leprosy, leprosy is not something we deal with very much in our time, but leprosy was a very serious thing, considered to be highly contagious, to where if anyone even touched you with their skin, you would get it too. The skin deforms in a way that's very hard to look at. It just turns people into a thing they feel so much shame because of their appearance. In fact, with the understanding of how contagious it was back in the time, it was so bad and so contagious, they felt that they needed to move people away into a leper colony. That if you caught leprosy, the whole family walked away, everybody walked away from you, and they moved you. You couldn't work with everyone else. You couldn't do anything. They moved you into a colony. And do you know where they put these colonies? They put the colony downwind of the city. The people live here, and we don't want the lepers' air blowing on us. This is how big it was. Why? Because we don't want to breathe or touch or get any of their stuff on us. This is the mindset first century Israel. So the lepers lived downwind in a colony because they were so contagious. And Jesus comes down off this hill, and this man with leprosy drops right in front of Jesus, just right in front of him. And I guarantee you, everyone's like, "Whoa, step back. Give yourself breathing room, Jesus. Step back. That guy's got, you know what, leprosy." And this is the scene, very first miracle. This is the scene. So this man with leprosy, he's right in front of Jesus. And one thing I notice about Jesus, and it's important for you and I to take note of this, Jesus does not fear any human condition. Jesus does not fear any human condition, because this guy was a leper, and back in his culture, a leper would be considered one of the avoided ones, the kind of people you just simply avoid because a lot of reasons you just avoid them. This leper was considered one of the avoided ones, and I just want to ask you this morning, in your mind, who would you consider in our society to be the ones who are avoided? The ones you just walk around, the ones you kind of dodge, because this is exactly the context of first century Israel. The ones you just kind of avoid. Who would it be? I remember when the AIDS epidemic really broke out, a lot of people were like, "Ooh, I didn't know what to do with it." And then later on they understand, and you know, people are coming and loving and helping those who are affected by AIDS. But I remember when it first came out, everyone's like, "Ooh, the avoided ones." Do you guys remember that? Right? Okay, same kind of things. Treated that Jesus didn't act that way. He never backed away from a human condition by fear. And so today, sometimes maybe homeless communities. You guys see some of these homeless communities around our city? Do you guys know we have the largest homeless population in the country? In the country? It's an epidemic. It's communities under bridges and stuff, and there's full communities. And a lot of times homeless is viewed as, "Oh, what do we do?" And Jesus never did that. It was never his demeanor. It was never his disposition. He wasn't like, "Ooh," ever. And this is really important. He comes up to Jesus with his leprosy, and he says this, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. If you are willing, you can." This is really important. He's saying, "I know you can if you are willing. I believe you can but I pray that you're willing. Are you willing? Are you willing, Jesus? Now, has anyone prayed that same kind of prayer? I believe you can, but are you willing? Can I get some honesty? Have you prayed this prayer before? I believe you can, Jesus. I believe you can heal, but I don't know if you're willing. I hope you're willing, but I don't know if you're willing. Are you willing? I love this leper because he represents us the way we think about God. God can do all things. Jesus can heal. I believe you can. But I don't know if you're concerned about me, or I don't know if you're going to say no, or I don't know if you want to. And we get into this thing of, well, I know you can, but. And we back away from the opportunity. This leper comes flying up to Jesus, drops on his knees right in front of him, breathing air on him. And Jesus is standing right there and says, I believe you can if you're willing. Are you willing? And I would suggest this, if you're a note taker today, there's some really key points about how this translates to your life personally. I want to encourage you to write some of these down, put them in your phone or wherever you keep notes like that. The first one is this. The best posture to request healing is kneeling before Jesus. The best posture to request healing is kneeling before Jesus. If you need something from Jesus, if you're like, God, I know, I believe you can, but I don't know if you're willing. I hope you're willing. I found myself in that situation many, many times, and I trust you have too. It should be a regular thing in our lives that we're going to him for the solution. And the best posture to request healing is kneeling, because it's requesting and it's a recognition of his authority. Some people act like kids, just demanding things from God. Little kids walk around, they demand things. Sometimes they don't understand authority and respect. They have to grow into that. But I would suggest to you, this leper gets it. He gets it. The best posture to request healing is kneeling before Jesus. And this is an intense moment. This guy with leprosy, he was so contagious. And the crowd's like, will he actually touch him? No. No, he's not going to actually touch him. And Jesus starts reaching forward. And people are like, no, he's not really going to do it, is he? And he's getting closer. Really? He's going to? And Jesus reaches out. Leprosy, contagious. That you too could be in the leper colony. Or so was the fear. And Jesus reaches out and touches him first. And after he touches him, he says, I am willing. It's interesting, he didn't say, I am willing, and turn around and say, he just reached right out to this leper and touched this guy. And says, I'm willing. And the passage says that he was cleaned. I am willing, be clean. And he was cleansed immediately. I love this. I love this. Listen, here's something to understand too. With there are people in our society that are considered the avoided ones. You might not want to call them that. It's not politically correct. It's not ethically correct. But you know in your heart there are avoided people. Come to terms in your own heart. Who are the avoided ones? Who are the avoided ones? Because Jesus didn't avoid them. And listen, this is a second point this morning. If we are paralyzed by the natural, by what we see, if we're paralyzed by the natural, we might miss out on the miracle. If we're paralyzed by the natural, we might miss out on the miracle. Jesus is willing to have an encounter with a leper, which is unheard of. But he wasn't paralyzed by like, ooh, wait a second, I don't know, dude. Get downwind from me first. Keep your distance. He wasn't paralyzed. There was no paralysis based on what he was seeing. And there shouldn't be in our lives either. With anyone you see or encounter who would be in this category of, God bless you, but you don't want to touch him. This would be one of the avoided ones. It would be like modern day leprosy. If you see someone homeless, you're willing to hand him a dollar, but you don't want to put your hand on him. Or you don't want to. It'd be the same kind of thing. Same kind of thing. If we're paralyzed by the natural, we might miss out on the miracle, okay? This is really important. Jesus modeled this for us. And then he tells him, show yourselves to the priest, which the law of Moses said, if God did something, you go and show and you make the offering to the Lord in the temple. And the principle of this is simply this, guys, when it comes to healing, is that after you are healed, you and I too are supposed to testify and give God the glory. You got to testify and give God the glory. In Scripture, some do testify and give God the glory. And in Scripture, some don't. Jesus told the lepers, I healed all of you guys. There's another passage coming up later on, a whole group of lepers. He heals them all. And most of them just run off and continue their life. They're like, finally. And only one comes back to thank Jesus and to follow through. And we look at Scripture, some do thank him and testify, and some don't. And to be honest with you, I've run into believers where we've prayed and we've seen God move, and a month later they're saying, well, I'm healed because I changed my diet. I'm healed because I, you know, whatever. And it's like, well, wait a second. Did you forget what happened? And this happens so quickly where in our mind we begin to justify things in the natural. We put things in a scientific realm. Look, thank God for doctors. Thank God for medical breakthroughs. Thank God for all of it. Use wisdom. Use it all. However, don't forget to go to the great physician. Amen? He's Jehovah Rapha, the Lord your God had heals. He was the healer even in the Old Testament before Jesus came. He was the Lord your God who heals. That's how Israel knew him to be. And when God does heal, and when God does break through in your life, and you're struggling in an area, or somebody you know is, and you see God lift a burden or change an affliction, you got to do what he's saying right here. You got to testify and give God the glory. Because some people do and some people don't. You got to testify and give God the glory. So that's what this guy does. Second miracle in the Bible is followed immediately after the leper. The leper is like the most unlikely guy to get a healing, because no one would think the Messiah would actually walk up and touch a leper. That's something you don't do. The next miracle is probably the next least likely miracle in the Bible too that you would expect to see. And this one has to do with a Gentile. The first guy was an avoided one, an untouchable. In India, they have the untouchables in a caste system. Lepers were like that, untouchables. And even if you got healed, you'd be an untouchable for life because they're afraid it's going to come back and you would get it. And Jesus is like, I don't do caste system. How many of you know Jesus doesn't do a caste system? There's no caste system. God is not partial, okay? There's no caste system in the kingdom of God. And so Jesus, you know, totally demolishes that idea of a caste system, that anyone is better than anyone or anyone's not touchable. He shatters it. And then he moves on to this next one and the next miracle. The next guy getting in on this miracle breakthrough is a Gentile. And the Gentiles, according to Israel, simply don't deserve it. They're not family. They don't deserve it. This is the mindset, first century Israel. It moves on in verse 5 and says, when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him asking for help. Lord, he said, my servant lies at home paralyzed, suffering terribly. Jesus said to him, shall I come and heal him? The centurion replied, Lord, I do not deserve to have you come under my roof, but just say the word and my servant will be healed. For I myself am a man under authority with soldiers under me, and I tell this one, go, and he goes, and that one, come, and he comes. And I say to my servant, do this, and he does it. And I want to stop right there. He's in Capernaum now, second miracle, Roman centurion asking for help. The crowd's got to be like, wow, where is this one going to go? The leper is one thing, but you got to understand, a Roman centurion, Israel is under Roman occupation. The Romans are the bad guys. They're the bad guys. It'd be like if Nazi Germany came and took over America and we're under them. What are you going to have? You're going to go talk to the Nazi commander in charge of everything and do him a favor? This is what it's like. Israel is under Roman occupation. And this guy is a commander. He's a centurion. He's got at least 100 guys under his command. Some centurions can have up to 1,000, depending on what rank you're at. And every one of those centurions, every one of those soldiers had the authority to call other people into service, citizens like you and I. So this guy's got some power, and yet he's coming to Jesus to do something that he's powerless to pull off on his own. The scene would be extreme for the bad guy to come to Jesus in front of everybody asking for something like this. Here's the problem. His problem, the centurion's problem, is bigger than the authority that he has. He's a man of authority. He's got authority. He can have 100 to 1,000 guys doing everything that he tells him to do, plus all the civilians they pull into this. That's how much authority he has. Yet his problem is bigger than his authority. I encourage you to write this down this morning because this applies to you as well. When your problem is bigger than your authority, you need to go to the authority bigger than your problem. When your problem is bigger than your authority. You can't pull it off. You can't fix it on your own. You just don't have the power and the capacity to fix your problem. When your problem is bigger than your authority, you need to go to the authority bigger than your problem. And that's what that centurion understood. We need to learn from this guy. He understood this full well. Even being a Gentile, not in a Jewish faith, he could read this one from a mile away. My problem's bigger than my authority. I need to go to the one who has authority over my problem. And this guy, he understands authority. He knows how to identify authority. Obviously, no doctor can fix this. And he's like, I need the one who has authority over sickness. And there's not many around that can do that except for Jesus, Messiah. It's one thing to know about sickness. It's one thing to know about sickness. Doctors know about sickness. It's a whole nother thing to have authority over sickness. Amen? It's one thing to know about sickness. It's good. It's another thing to have authority over sickness. Jesus has authority over sickness. And so this passage here is teaching us on healing, the first, second healing in the Bible. He came down from the hill. They recognized his authority. It's the second miracle in the Bible, and this passage is about authority. I would encourage you to write this one down. It's our fourth point this morning. Healing is a matter of authority. Healing is a matter of authority. And Jesus, the Son of God, had the authority to heal every sickness. And this is an important reality, an important spiritual fact, because later on, he starts to tell us about our authority through him and what he's done and where he wants us to go in the things that he has done. This is what's important. Healing is a matter of authority. The centurion is saying this. Jesus is like, you want me to come to your house? And the centurion says, hey, listen, I know what I can command, and I also got a pretty good idea, Jesus, on what you can command. So Jesus is like, so do you want me to come to your house? And the centurion is saying, look, I'm not even worthy to have you come anywhere near my house. If you knew who I was, my heart condition, my life, I am not worthy to have the Jewish Messiah step into my house. I'm not worthy, but I believe Jesus. Listen to this. I believe, this is a Gentile, a centurion. I believe, Jesus, that with your authority, you can command healing from far away without even being there. That's what I believe. Come on. You guys see that? I believe with your authority, you don't even have to be there, Jesus. That you can say it from here and it will be done over there. How many of you guys believe that? That Jesus can command healing without being physically present? This is important. Come to turn. I want to ask that one more time. How many of you guys really believe that Jesus can command healing without being physically there? That's important. Remember your answer on that. That's important because it can be a game changer in your life. We see it modeled in the very second miracle in Scripture. And by the way, I don't see anywhere else in Scripture where anyone asked Jesus to do something so bold as this. Every time in Scripture, they're bringing their sick to Jesus, or they're asking Jesus, Jesus, will you come over here? Oh, Jesus, will you come over here? Every other miracle, and from my understanding, my read of Scripture, they're asking Jesus, please come here, or we're going to get this person to you, whatever we have to do, we're going to bring somebody to you. And this guy is like, Jesus, I got so much faith in your authority that you don't even have to show up at my house physically. You could speak it here and now, and it will get done. Wow, that's amazing. That's what the centurion believes. Jesus can heal without being physically present. Moves on to verse 10 and says, when Jesus heard this, he was amazed and said to those following him, truly I tell you, I have not found anyone in Israel with such great faith. I say to you that many will come from the east and from the west and will take their places at the feast of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven, but the subjects of the kingdom will be thrown outside into the darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then Jesus said to the centurion, go, let it be done just as you believed it would. You might want to underline that in your Bible. Go, let it be done just as you believed it would. And this servant was healed at the moment. Really quickly, as a summary on this portion, Jesus is saying the Israelites are sitting there, the people of Israel, and they're thinking, well, wait a second. We're the sons of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We're the ones that are entitled to the kingdom. We're the ones who should get in on all of this stuff, Jesus. And we're a little confused because this guy's a Gentile, and this Gentile is a centurion, and you're doing a miracle for him. And Jesus is listening to the faith of the centurion. He's never heard faith this amazing before. And he goes, this guy's getting rewarded for his faith. And Jesus is like saying, the kingdom of God isn't an automatic entry because you're born Jewish. It comes through faith in the Messiah, Jesus. When you have faith in who he is and what he did for you, that's how you get in the kingdom, not because of a birthright, not because you were born in a family, in a place, in a time. That doesn't qualify you for the kingdom of God. Faith in Jesus does. And every tribe, tongue, and nation, he's going to say, every tribe, tongue, and nation can come into the kingdom, not by their right, but by faith in Jesus Christ. It's amazing. And so he says the subjects of the kingdom won't make it in. And what that means, the subjects of the kingdom, it means the children of royalty, the Jewish children of royalty, saying, well, we're the sons of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We grow up under Moses, so we're the automatic ones, aren't we? And Jesus is like, no, there are no automatic ones. There's no automatic kingdom entry. It's for the whole world, the message, who walks through Jesus by faith and who he is and what he did for you. Those are the ones from the east, far east, all the way from China to the far west, America, and the north and south, every tribe, tongue, and nation. And for the Jewish audience at this time, they're going, whoa, first the leper, and now a Roman centurion who we thought was the enemy. And these guys, Jesus is saying, are all being included into the kingdom. And Jesus is telling us, because we were born Jewish, we don't automatically have the right. It's by faith. Whoa. And they're watching these miracles. Pretty explosive. So the first miracle was somebody requesting their own healing. The second miracle was somebody requesting healing for somebody else. How many of you know sometimes it's easier to have faith for somebody else's healing? Have you ever done that? You got greater faith for someone else's healing than you do your own. It's interesting. That's the way we think sometimes. And I think the way we do that is because, like the leper, we say, I believe you can, Lord, but I don't know if you're willing. You know, it's just me. Are you willing? And I think we misunderstand how loved we are by the living God, that he is our healer, that we are loved, that he has our best in mind. And I think we need to approach the throne with confidence, the Bible says, that we can come before him with a boldness and a confidence. Just as children run into the arms of their father, if they have a loving father, they can storm into the room and jump up on his lap, not like out of fear and phobia and stuff like that. And I think we need to understand that, because we see that in the miracles right here. One's being requested for themselves and one for somebody else. Jesus says to this guy, about this guy, when he asked Jesus to say the word to heal his servant so far away, when Jesus doesn't even have to go to his house, Jesus is like, that is phenomenal. Did you guys hear that? He's telling the crowd. Did you just hear that? He says that he's amazed. He says, what great faith. He says, I have not experienced anyone with bigger faith in all of Israel. No one so far has made a statement of that kind of faith. In the Greek, this means mega. Great means mega. Mega faith. Everyone say mega faith. This centurion, who's not even Jewish, has got straight up mega faith. And Jesus is saying, wow. Did you guys hear that mega faith that just came out of his mouth? Mega faith. This guy is getting in on a miracle that no one else has gotten in, the healing from the distance, at least. Later on, we see others do this kind of thing where Jesus heals from far away, but this is the first one who actually asks for it. No one's ever asked for healing from far away, and this guy does, and it's because of mega faith. It says that Jesus was amazed. Amazed. Have you ever thought of something in your life that you can do that would amaze Jesus? I mean, amaze Jesus. He's God's son. He's Emmanuel. He's seen it all, right? This centurion amazed him. Amazed him. Some translations say Jesus was marveled, just marveled, like, wow, that's marvelous. Others say that Jesus was astonished. You think of Jesus being astonished. Jesus was astonished. He marveled. He was amazed because of mega faith. Mega faith. Fifth point this morning, if you want to write this down, is mega faith amazes Jesus. Mega faith amazes Jesus. That's some big faith right there. You know, we believe, guys, we believe the Word of God, but do we believe the Word of God? I mean, I know we believe it. We believe it. But do we believe it? Do we believe it enough to step out and do what it says? Do we believe on that level, or do we believe on a whole different level, on a subdued level? This centurion is stepping way outside the box. This is like Peter getting out of the boat kind of faith. It's like, whoa, that's on the mega category. And that's really important. Jesus says to him, listen, he says right after that, after the guy makes a statement like that, Jesus is like, wow, guys, that's astonishing. Did you hear that? He goes right on to say, go, it will be done just as you believed it would. Just, it's going to be done the way you believed it would. His servant was healed at that very moment. So write this one down because it's in the scripture. The miracle came just as he believed it would. I'd encourage you to write that down. Some of you are going, well, it doesn't mean mine is, so I'm not going to write it down. Well, listen. In the Word of God, his miracle came just as he believed it would. God is sovereign. God is sovereign. He can do anything, anytime, any way he wants or doesn't want. He's sovereign. He's sovereign. We don't control God. He is sovereign. But had the centurion not asked, we wouldn't be reading about a miracle right here. Had he not asked the sovereign one to do a miracle, we wouldn't be reading about a miracle. And had he not believed in this particular example, I'm not saying this is every case of every miracle in life, but in this particular case, had he not asked and had he not believed, we wouldn't be reading about a miracle. So the last point is this, and it's an important one, that when it comes to healing, God wants and loves and rewards our faith when it comes to healing. God wants and loves and rewards our faith. Again, God's sovereign. He could do it without your faith. He can do anything he wants whenever he wants. But when you look at scripture and you look at the faith component of healing in the Bible, you cannot separate faith from the component. Whether it's you coming in faith or you come and bringing your friend in faith, whether it's for your healing or for somebody else's healing, faith is right smack in the middle of the equation. When it comes to healing, God wants, loves, and rewards our faith. Here's what Hebrews 11:6 says. We have for the screen. It says, and without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. So without faith, it's impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists. I believe we're here today. Most of us in this room believe he exists. That's great. So without faith, that's great. You have to believe he exists, right? But it also says, and believe that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. These rewards are gifts. They're blessings beyond what you and I deserve. They're things that God's going to do and bless us with. And the Bible says it's by faith. So these things come by faith. So when it comes to healing, God wants, loves, and rewards our faith. The centurion received healing because he understood authority and he exercised his faith. Now, I believe we are supposed to do the same. Recognize that Jesus has authority over sickness and we're supposed to exercise our faith. Some of you are thinking, yeah, but if I do that, what if God doesn't heal? How many feel that way? Come on, honestly. If I pray for someone, they don't get healed, then what? Right? Come on, honestly, right? Okay. We can't let that drive the equation. No one in Scripture is like, oh, maybe I should, but what if God doesn't, so I better not. No, listen, guys, we have to trust in the Sovereign One. We have to recognize his authority, but we also have to exercise faith. These stories in the Bible wouldn't have happened that we just read if there wasn't faith being exercised. So after a long day of healing, this last section, it says that Jesus is going to head over to Peter's house because Jesus heard that Peter's mom makes a mean falafel. And so they're going to head over to Peter's house and they're going to get in on some mean falafels, the best falafels west of the Jordan River. And so they go over to Peter's house. And it says in verse 14, when Jesus came into Peter's house, he saw Peter's mother-in-law lying in bed with a fever. He touched her hand, and the fever left her. And she got up and began to wait on them. And when evening came, many who were demon-possessed were brought to him, and he drove out the spirits with a word and healed the sick. This was to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet Isaiah. He took our infirmities and bore our disease. The third miracle in the Bible that we're seeing, followed by many, is Peter's mother-in-law. Peter, first apostle, is married. Peter is married, and his mother-in-law is in the house. And he's sick with a fever. And Jesus reaches over and heals her. And she gets up to make those mean falafels we were talking about. But the point is this, guys. Jesus even cares about the little things. He cares about the fevers in your home. Jesus cares about the fevers in your home. And you got to know that. Because you think sometimes maybe he's concerned about the big things, but maybe not the little things. No, Jesus cares about the fevers in your home. He touched her, the fever left. She popped up and started serving dinner. Even the ones in your house, God calls about the fevers. You know, Christy and I have prayed. We've got 5 children. We've had plenty of fevers over the years. And some of them we do the Tylenol and this, and we pray and we just got to ride it out. But there's others that we have prayed and we've called on God and we've called on his authority, and God has broke the fever. We have seen and experienced God break fevers. We've seen him do that where there's no, they didn't even ride out the thing yet, or the Tylenol didn't kick in, or you didn't even give him anything. We've seen God break fevers. God cares about even fevers in your home. You got to know that. Even the little things. It's not just the lepers and the centurion's guy that he's crying out for. It's even in your home. You got to know that, because in your home, you got to trust in the authority of the one who heals, even in the little things. So instead of a nice, quiet evening, sitting, eating their falafels after a long day of healing, they hear a noise outside, and they look out the window, and they see a big, long line of people. Everyone's bringing everyone to Jesus, because everyone knows he's got authority over sickness. And so there's a long line of people, sick and demon-possessed, and he healed the sick, and he cast out the demons with a word, all proof that Jesus was the Jewish Messiah living among them. Isaiah 53, for any of your Jewish friends, you read Isaiah 53 and you say, wow, Jesus is the Messiah who did all these things. Anybody you know who's Jewish, you have them read Isaiah 53 and you're like, wow, that's Jesus. Check, 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 Messiah. You keep checking the Messiah box. Messiah, 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 Messiah. Wow. He really was the Messiah. He really did do all these things. In closing, I just want to share some of these things. When it comes to healing, guys, when it comes to healing, 2 things. After our service today, we want to have the opportunity to pray for you. Any of you today that are suffering in any area, for an area that you want God to heal in your life. Maybe you already go to doctors, maybe you don't. Maybe it's something new that's popped up in your life, a pain, an arthritis, whatever it might be, bad news from the doctor. We want to pray today by faith, trusting God. The Bible tells us to do that. If there's any sick among you, you're supposed to come and get prayer. The Bible says that to the New Testament believer. So we want to do that today, but I want to just share this with healing, because some people believe and will press into God and will seek God for healing, and some people simply won't do it. Christians, they won't do it. I want to encourage you with a thought this morning. Don't let your experience dictate your theology. This is important. Don't let your experience dictate your theology. Your experience might say, I've prayed before and I never got healed, so God doesn't heal. Many people have done that. They have seen something or not seen something, and what they saw or didn't see becomes their theology. You don't want to do that. You want this to be your theology, okay? Don't go beyond what's written. He's given us everything we need for life and godliness. You want this to be your theology. But at the same time, family, if it's in the book, you better believe it. If it's in the book, you better believe it. And if the sick are being healed and it's in the book, in the New Testament church, after Jesus' ascension, you better believe it. There's raising the dead. There's healing the sick. There's casting out. It's all in the book in the New Testament church. And so the same way you don't let your experience dictate your theology, you let the Bible dictate your theology, right? But this is what you also do. You pray that the Bible will begin to dictate your experience. You pray that what's in the book will be a reality in your life. Because the early believers walked with Jesus in the fullness of the Holy Spirit, and they understood close to the source what Jesus meant. And they began to walk this out in faith, and they began to see and experience things. So their experience didn't change their theology. The Word of God based made the foundation, made the solid rock foundation of their theology. But if it's in the book, they believed it, and they said, God, you said it. Will you do it? Will you do it again? And that's a great, healthy way to come to an understanding of that. And as a Christ follower, God called you into the ministry of healing. Did you know that? As a Christ follower, God called you into the ministry of healing as well. He came to bind up the brokenhearted. He came to set captives free. We too are ministers of this gospel of reconciliation, connecting people to God. The early believers were saying, God, will you stretch out your arm? Will you do something powerful, God? Listen, I don't have the power of healing and you don't either, but God does. People don't heal, but God does. And when we partner with him, we have to have the faith to do what he says to do. We don't take the credit for it. But if he doesn't do it, you don't take the blame for it either. This is where you have to trust God. But I want to encourage you, because some of you guys believe in healing, but you don't step out in it. Some of you don't believe in it. And I think God's trying to tell you today, hey, it's in the book. Pray that your experience lines up with the book. That's what really he's saying. Jesus said that healing the sick is part of the responsibility of every believer. In Mark 16, 18, it says this. Jesus says that believers would lay hands on the sick, believers, as part of the ones who go out and testify, as part of the Great Commission of go ye therefore and tell somebody about my love, as part of you get up and go public for me and share it with your friend, share it with your neighbor, share it with the person in the cubicle next to you, whatever it might be, in the context of that, in that same statement, in that framework, in that same context, he said, when you go do this, he said that believers in that context will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. We don't take credit for when or how. We leave that to God. But we walk in what the book says. That's the point, family. And I want to encourage you. Some of you, you've never laid hands on anybody and prayed for anybody with faith. And God's saying it's time to start doing that. It's time for you, when your kids are sick, to not just go to the doctor, get the medicine, do whatever you need to do in the natural. That's fine. But you better stop and lay hands on your kids and pray in the name of Jesus that God will break a fever and that God will bring a healing. We've seen too many healings. The Bible's full of the stories in our own lives. I've prayed and seen the cancer numbers go away. I've prayed and seen situations where there's got to be back surgery for all kinds of broken disc stuff and that go away and there's no surgery. I've prayed for my own little guy who's got symptoms and we see progress, but I haven't seen the breakthrough. But guess what? I'm not quitting, because faith doesn't quit. I'm not going to base whether God heals or not based on one thing. I'm going to go with the book says, because listen, I'm not going to let my experience dictate my theology. I'm going to ask that my experience will line up with the book. That's the point, family. And so this stuff is real. We serve the great physician. That's who he is. That's his name, Jehovah Rapha, the Lord your God who heals. And he did that in the Old Testament before Jesus even came and said, all authority has been given to me. And now therefore you go. And guess what? I'm going to be with you wherever you go, Jesus said. So when you go out to go public, you go in the authority of God. And Jesus is like, I'm going to be with you to the ends of the earth. I asked you earlier, do you believe Jesus can heal without physically being there? And most of you said, well, yes. Okay. So therefore, I want to encourage you today to walk that out. If you believe Jesus can heal without physically being there, trust in his words that I will be with you to the ends of the earth. The most important thing is that people come to know who Jesus is. It takes away their sins, they're saved. That's the most important things. But after that, we want people to walk in the provisions of God. And if Jesus says that part of our sharing is to pray for people in faith and leave the rest with him, we don't take the credit for it. No one has a healing ministry with their names in lights. That's not, the Holy Spirit's not behind that. The Holy Spirit doesn't endorse someone's healing ministry with their names in life where they get the glory. God has to get the glory. We can remain anonymous, but we still lay hands on the sick. The Bible says they'll recover and we'll leave the rest to God. My question is, are you willing to leave the rest to God? Because a lot of folks, if they don't see the healing, the fear is, well, what will that person think then? That's not up to you. That is not up to you. That's above our pay grade. We don't take the weight of that on. That has nothing to do with your weight or my weight. We leave that up to the sovereign one. He's the sovereign one. But we stand and we contend and we pray and we use faith. And we try to be like the centurion and use mega faith. And Jesus says when we use the mega faith, the scripture is saying it's impossible to please God without faith. But when we use big faith, it astonishes Jesus. And he's a rewarder of those who seek him. So I just want to encourage you, how much more would Jesus do if we believed? How much more might you be able to see in your life if we only had mega faith? God's the one who does it, we don't. But we have to believe. And so, again, this book in your life could be something down here, or it could be something here where, in theory, we believe it. Or we can elevate its authority and say, you said it, it's in the book, I believe it. He tells me to do the stuff in the book. I'm going to believe the book. I'm not even going to go off my experience. I'm going to go off the book. And if he says that when I go out and share faith, share Jesus, that I'm supposed to lay hands on the sick, who am I to say no to that? So the question is, where do you put this book in your life? Don't go beyond what's written. Some know it's in the book, but they'd like to remove those pages and say, don't worry about that today anymore. Ripping pages, don't worry about that stuff anymore. And they'll say to you, that died with the apostles. Nowhere in scripture does it say it died with the apostles. In fact, we have proof in history that this stuff continued. The things of God continued through the early church. So I would just encourage you, you can choose in your life what kind of authority level you tend to give this book, but Jesus had the authority to heal. I would say put it where it belongs. Put it up here in your life. He's given you everything you need for life and godliness. Trust in the authority of God's word. Believe it. Have mega faith and walk it out because he says to. And so I just believe you're going to see God move in your life if you elevate faith in what God says. And that's how we want to close this morning. We want to close in prayer that God would seal some of these things in our heart. Again, we're going to pray for any after the service who have any need, burden, request. We don't heal. I don't heal. And you don't heal. But God does. And we want to have mega faith in the God who heals. With man, it's impossible. But nothing's impossible with God. And so this is where your mega faith comes into the picture. You got to believe to take a step. So mighty God, we love you. We praise you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the power of it. I just pray your word would take an elevated place in our life. That, Lord, our experience would not dictate our theology, but your word would dictate our theology. And if it's in the book, we would simply believe it. We wouldn't discount it. We wouldn't minimize it. We wouldn't start pulling some pages out of scripture and try to take away from the big picture. Your word says don't add or take away from the book. That's the last words in the book say don't add or take away. We don't want to take away anything. It's in the book. We want to believe. And like the early church would say, God, would you please stretch out your hand and do some radical stuff again? And even the apostles who saw you do some miracles said, God, would you do it again? Would you stretch out your hand and do it again? They know they couldn't do it on their own. You did it through people. You've always been moving through people. And I just pray, God, you'd begin to not only move today through prayer, that there'd be healing in this house and that you would get the glory and people would testify like Jesus said to do. When you're healed, you give God the glory and you testify. You kneel, you know, you kneel before Jesus, and then you give God the glory and you testify. I pray, Lord, we'd be those kind of people. But I also pray, Lord, we would be people who believe that you've commissioned all of us to go ye therefore, to go out and tell somebody. And along the way, when we see somebody sick, that we would not be afraid, that fear would not rule us. Fear is not from you. Perfect love casts out all fear. And Lord, we'd have the boldness because you told us to say, would you mind if I pray for you? And we'd lay hands on the sick and we'd see them recover and more people would jump up and testify of your goodness. Nobody needs their name in lights. We want Jesus to be famous in our city. But we ask you to come in power. We ask this in Jesus' name and God's people said.
This has been a presentation of Valley Metro Church. To hear more messages or to support future podcasts, please visit us at valleymetrochurch.com.